And so, Kaniela, I thought the great thing to start with, and what I found in a lot of the truly progressive candidates who are running, are real stories about real people and your background and where you came from, a real working class family, a family where, you know, things did not come necessarily certainly not on a silver platter. And I wonder if you could just spend a minute or two and talk about your family and the kinds of challenges that you saw when you were a kid.
Sure. Thanks for having me. I think the majority of Congress are millionaires right now. And it's like one thing, you're absolutely right. Like, it's one thing to talk about minimum wage as a business owner. But I think more importantly, it's having someone who just worked a minimum wage job a few years ago. There's someone that can actually identify with folks. And, you know, my background isn't dissimilar to so many folks out there. My mom worked at a Macy's as a shoe clerk. My dad was a waiter at a hotel. He was an ILWU member. And we didn't have much. And then my dad unexpectedly passed away from a brain aneurysm, mainly because he didn't have health care. He tried to leave his job as a waiter in order to give us a better life and start this financial services sort of thing. You know, it took a while. It didn't really get off the ground. But because of that, he didn't have insurance. We had Medicaid. And he had migraines and he wasn't going to the doctor. So they didn't catch it. And it probably would have been caught if we had like a Medicare for all system. But regardless, my mom was left with four kids and her grandmother on her own. So we relied on Medicaid, free school lunch, Social Security, supplemental income, Pell Grants to become a first generation college graduate. All these programs that were like, they weren't achieved through compromise. They were achieved through progressive heroes in the past, really not letting up, and, you know, movements on the ground, folks organizing. So we were staunch Republicans growing up, and we realized in that situation, no matter how hard my mom worked, I was picking pineapple fields at 14. I was picking pineapple from the field at 14 years old to help it build. You know, no matter how hard we worked, we couldn't get ahead, and we relied on community and government and our teachers, and very quickly realized that this manifest destiny thing isn't a reality or isn't possible. And it really is all about community and lifting up working families. So that's why in this work, I try to lift the families like mine, because I know that so many others, we came out of the other side of some hard times, but I know so many others have not been so lucky.
And so your family were, you said, just said you were actually staunch Republicans.
I mean, that's the thing with a lot of that, like, people of from indigenous communities and not of a lot of means, they tend to be products of oppressive systems. And the systems tell you, you know, if you're not getting ahead, you're just not working hard enough. So that's kind of my experience, too. Like, a lot of my friends are Republicans, but a lot of the working class in America voted for Donald Trump. So it's easy to like blame yourselves and not, if you don't have like a power analysis and an understanding of how these systems, work. And it's not just about individuals. So it's, how do we communicate that as progressive leaders in a simple way that can really reach these folks who are looking for change?
Yeah. And your point about people blaming themselves, this is the thing about the American system, that the fact is that if you look at productivity, and you know this as you've studied all this information, and you actually became the head of your policy conference in the State House, so you're well versed in this, the system basically has stolen people's hard work over the last 30 years. Productivity has gone up, and it's not because, therefore, people are being paid less. It's not because they're not working. They're in fact working really hard, but the system is stealing from people.
That's right. Productivity has, in Hawaii, has tripled over the last 30 or 40 years, and wages have barely inched up. So I think if we're to keep up with productivity in Hawaii, our minimum wage would be around $23 right now, but it's at $10.10.
That's right. If you looked at it nationally, it might be like $20, $21 or $22 compared to the $7.25, the federal minimum wage. Each state has its differences, but if you kind of even it out over the overall, the whole country, it's around that. But still, that just says that even those of us like yourself who are campaigning and supporting a $15 minimum wage, federal minimum wage. That's not at all outrageous if you look at what really people should be earning.
Right. And all these arguments about unemployment going up with the wage, it just doesn't hold water. When you look at the history of minimum wage increases, the sky has never fallen. And, you know, part of it, when you look at it through an economic model, the idea is people will, if you raise wages, then people will leave, and like you can hire less folks. But for a lot of these folks, they don't have other options for jobs. They don't have the mobility, and they don't have the skills. And, you know, they're already tied with like where they live. So there's no economic substitute, as economists would say. So they're stuck in that job no matter how little they're being paid. So these wages aren't even market wages. The market is distorted to begin with.
Mm-hmm. Now, one of the things that you're trying to distinguish yourself compared to your opponents in the primary, and this is a really solid Democratic district, so clearly whoever wins the primary is going to win the general election, is basically you're the only candidate who's rejected campaign contributions from corporations and what you say they're DC lobbyists. And that's obviously an important issue for progressives, and it's certainly something that Bernie Sanders ran on. Tell me what you've seen in terms of the influence of money, and certainly you have some experience having run for the state house at the ripe old age of 22 years old, so you know what the impact of money is.
Right. So when I first ran for office, there was a Tea Party Republican that got elected on my home island, and I didn't want to let my community get sold out to the multinational corporations that were supporting them. So I took a shot. I was working at Four Seasons, clocking in at 4 a.m. until noon, and then just knocking on doors until sunset. And we're outspent, I think, over the course of both elections, 10 to 1. And we ended up winning by 26%, just knocking on doors and grinding it out. So because of that, once I got in, I wasn't really tied to the typical folks that have corporations that have control over politics. And I'd be on the floor taking a vote, and literally there'll be lobbyists up in the chamber watching us and texting our cell phones, like, we're going to remember this next year. Just like doing threats while we're voting, not even cryptically, you know, just like very, very overtly, trying to influence us. And I could just ignore them. So over the last, since 2012, I was able to just vote my conscience and stand with my community. And it's really been encouraging and heartening to see like folks come out that would normally not be involved or would normally be so jaded by politics to support our race. So this time around, I'm rejecting all corporate money. We're at over 2,000 individual donors in a couple months. It's by far the record in this district. Lots of small donations of $25, even less. Sometimes even like $5 or $3, and it's really picking up, and it's really nice not having to ask for like $5,000 a pop from people that, you know, will ask for favors later on. But that said, I wouldn't have to do this to stand up for my opponents, because none of them are campaigning or to support Medicare for All, public tuition-free public college, and end of reckless regime change wars, all these issues that living wages, all these issues that we really care about as progressives, none of them are campaigning on those values that united us in 2016. And additionally, not even progressive issues, but just Democratic baseline issues, all three of my opponents, it's an open seat in a Democratic primary, all three of my opponents have histories, recent histories opposing marriage equality, women's reproductive freedom, criminal justice reform, and other issues that are just baseline Democratic issues. So I think we already stand out. I'm just taking this stance of no corporate money to really double underscore what we stand for.
Mm-hmm. And I was reading some of your Twitter feed, and one tweet caught my eye just from a little bit ago. And this is about an issue then, which I think does seem to distinguish you from, let's say, the establishment Democrats. And I'm quoting the tweet: "Remember when Dems caved to the GOP and the 2011 sequester happened? That same GOP is about to reverse it, spend billions, and reap the rewards. May we please stop getting had?" I love that last sentence.
And stop getting had.
And we're talking in the context of this budget deal, which I also tweeted out recently. Here are all these Democrats supporting a budget deal that's going to put more billions of dollars into the war machine, which already just got a huge allocation for 2018. The 2018 budget that was already passed, the appropriations mm-hmm. budget, was $700 billion. So it seems to me, and you'll explain what your tweet, what you thought about this, seems to me that you're seeking to be a true progressive Democrat in the House.
That's right. I'm a true progressive Democrat, and I'm seeking to get in the House. Look, in Hawaii, like, our top three industries is tourism, military, and then real estate. And, you know, none of those are sustainable. Real estate and tourism, it relies on the preservation of our iconic beauty, but also the destruction of it or building it up. Mm-hmm. And then military, this idea that our livelihoods here in Hawaii is tied to the death and destruction of others abroad is abhorrent. It's completely immoral. And this idea that if war were to stop, then our economy would stop. Like, it's fascinating that we're still fighting for this and not letting this in, not trying to transition away from that sort of economy based on war. When people say, like, what are we going to do if we move away from our military-based economy? And just spend that money on infrastructure. That's actual local jobs and good paying jobs here in Hawaii. We have so much work that needs to be done with roads to be repaired and bridges and just the basics that government should be doing that we're not doing because we're too busy carpet bombing cities in the Middle East and hiring no bid contractors to clean it up. And those same contractors happen to be the biggest donors, not just for Republicans, for Democrats as well. So how do we resist that sort of influence? And it's by rejecting their money.
And I assume, just so it's clear, that the military is one of the three top industries because of the bases there, especially the Navy. But I assume also you have Air Force bases there as well, given the geographic place of Hawaii in the Pacific.
Yeah, one third of the entire island of Oahu were 900,000 of the 1.1 million people in Hawaii reside. One third of that entire island is federally owned, mostly by the military.
Wow, that's incredible. So to kind of now give a feel for the ground, you're a seasoned candidate. You've run for office before. You're running for Congress. What's changed in your mind when you go out and knock on doors that might be different from, let's say, 2 years ago? Have you noticed any difference in terms of how people are interacting with you or talking about issues?
Yeah, I mean, look, people think that we're more divided than we are, because when you look at MSNBC and Fox, everyone's just yelling at each other. It's obviously created for echo chambers, and it's a real partisan lens. So, you know, Democrats are really digging their heels for Republicans, but the majority of people aren't partisan. Mm-hmm. Partisans are a real minority, but they do identify with our progressive message. People don't see the world as left and right. I think there's a study done where only 17% of folks in America could correctly place the terms liberal with Democrat and conservative with Republican. The whole 80-some-odd percent of folks don't even see the world that way. That's just an elitist point of view that's left and right. It's important, but it's not realistic. The way people do see the world is this: are you with us, the people, or are you with this small group of elite, wealthy folks that are controlling everything? Republicans and Democrats, working class people, they get that. And that's why Bernie did so well. And that's why Trump did so well. If you look at his messaging, his last ads, it sounded like he was trying to use our language. He was trying to use progressive language, talking about elites controlling the levers of power. So that's my experience knocking on doors. If you're able to talk about how, you know, your hands are untied, you're unmoored from these corporate donors, that actually transcends these silos that we're told that we're stuck in. So that's been my experience so far.
And I assume, And I assume that the things that also resonate with people are when you simply say, hey, how about everybody have college for free? And that no matter who you are, you're guaranteed to have healthcare from cradle to grave. I mean, I assume that that's something that quite resonates very strongly with people.
Right. So how do you, instead of just trying to like work within the framework that politics is still kind of, it started with like Reagan in that era, and he sort of, it's all about budget and balance, and we're still, Democrats are still trying to still kind of going along with that paradigm, but we need to shift the conversation to being more about human needs. Why is it that in the richest country in the history of the world, we have so many people who are hungry and uneducated and unsheltered? There's no excuse. Everything should focus around basic human needs and how they probably shouldn't be used as for-profit commodities. My mind is not shouldn't be exploited for profit. My body shouldn't be exploited for profit through healthcare, and education. Like these things just make sense, and it's just the way we communicate them. And when you look at like these split the baby policies that we've passed in order to compromise with uncompromising Republicans, they don't work well. Like ACA was, like Affordable Care Act was designed, I think it was a good first step, but it was designed to purposely look invisible, to not look like a government handout. So people don't realize their benefits. So you can't even like really campaign on it. It's just a bad policy politically. But, and then also when you like means test things and you have like a pool of people who are getting benefits and you have other folks who aren't, the public pressure is like, it's going to squeeze those people. And it's going to shrink the funding, just because that's human nature. Good policy is good for everyone. That's why Medicare works. And that's why Social Security works. If you go up to people and you say, hey, how about instead of, folks getting, benefits off like your hard earned money, what if everybody chips in what they can and everybody gets back? Everybody gets the benefit. It works. And you go to like countries in people are okay with that. You go to countries in Europe, people are really happy. Even the richest folks are like, of course everyone should get healthcare because they get it themselves.